Well, hurricane season is upon us. We're now almost a week into it, and I wanted to bring in one of the hurricane forecasters from the Central Pacific Hurricane Center, Tom Birchard. He works over at the Honolulu Forecast Office, which is also, it's the National Weather Service Office and the Central Pacific Hurricane Office, and you're one of the weather forecasters, but on top of that, you have specialized training. I think you went to the National Hurricane Center. You got training to become a hurricane forecaster. Tell us a little bit about your qualifications there.
Thanks for having me, Chevy. Appreciate it. Well, I went to University of Hawaii, actually, got a bachelor's degree and a master's degree, and eventually got a job with the National Weather Service. A couple years in the office in Key West, Florida. A couple years at the office in Guam. Got to experience a landfalling typhoon, Pongsanwa. And then I've been a forecaster here with the National Weather Service in Honolulu since 2003.
So you've been doing this for quite some time, so you're one of the best over there. So let's show the graphic for the hurricane season, what the outlook is for, and this came out last month, and we're talking about 2 to 4 storms expected in the Central Pacific. Now, that could be storms that form in the Eastern Pacific, and the Eastern Pacific's forecast is for 10 to 17 named storms. They had 19 last year. So for each of us, the Central Pacific and the Eastern Pacific, that's a little below average. So that's good news to start the season, correct?
Yeah, but one of the mantras that we like to embrace is that it only takes one. So even though we're expecting a season that may be a little bit less active than normal here in the islands, we always want to alert residents and visitors to the fact that it only takes one system to have a dramatic impact on our lives.
So I wanted to ask you, okay, so let's just quickly take us through the process. You get a storm, it forms, whether it's in the Eastern Pacific or Central Pacific, and you are now in charge of forecasting for that storm. I've seen you do it. You're extremely busy for the 12 hours. There's a lot that goes into it. So you take the storm, and just a brief overview of how you handle that forecast-wise.
Well, we have to make sure we have the staffing in place. We work the 12-hour shifts, as you mentioned, from 6 to 6, essentially, and then we coordinate with the Hurricane Center in Miami as to what time we think the system would cross 140 West into the Central Pacific. We try to estimate that and get our staffing ready and in place. And then once we take the storm over, there's already a certain amount of momentum typically with the forecast. And so we tend not to want to make too many dramatic changes to the forecast from cycle to cycle. Even before we inherit the system from the National Hurricane Center, if it's a westward moving system coming from the Eastern Pacific, we may have already been in contact with the folks that run their or help organize the reconnaissance and their hurricane hunters.
So that's my next question. When would you say, okay, we need the hurricane hunters, you call them in, and how important is that information they give you?
Oh, it's extremely important. Most times without the hurricane hunters, we're sort of estimating the intensity and the size of a hurricane. And we could do that fairly well with satellite, but that's sort of an estimation. When we have the aircraft in there, even though it's aircraft, we like to call it ground truth because it's actually sampling not only the maximum sustained winds associated with the storm, but also the size. And that can be critical in helping to forecast the surf and the impacts potentially on the islands, because just because the center of a system doesn't pass over the islands, if the peripheral winds affect us, the aircraft data can help us understand how large and how far out those strong winds extend from the center.
So you have the Air Force Reserve C-130s. You also have the Lockheed. You have the G-4 from the NOAA. So there are actually three different planes that can do this. So let me ask you this to wrap this up. We're celebrating the 30th anniversary of Aniki. Now, back then, 30 years ago, the one problem that it was a big problem, is they didn't have much lead time to prepare as far as watches and warnings go. For whatever the reason, we weren't there. But that was 30 years ago. With all of our tools now, new satellites, hurricane hunter data, which is a lot better, model data, could that ever happen again?
I'd say the situation with Aniki, pretty much no, because the quality of the satellite data, just the improvement in the satellite data that we get is dramatic. And then also the forecast models and the computing power that we have allows us to run ensembles of forecast models. And so with all of that data now, I would pretty much say that a surprise turn that Aniki gave us would be very well anticipated. Wouldn't be a surprise.
Well, that makes us feel a lot better, Tom. Tom, my very good friend, thank you for joining us this early hour. We really appreciate it, and we feel a lot better now knowing exactly how you do it, and you really care about it, you guys over there, and we're really appreciative of what you guys do over there. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Appreciate you.
Well.